Well, good morning, Fort Creek. If you will, stand with us this morning and worship with us.
Great is thy we should be faithful to Him every day.
Amen. It's a great song declaring what the Lord is trying to do in our lives, the fact that we can trust in Him. One of my favorite statements that Jesus made was at the end, before the ascension, and He said, "I will be with you always. I'm leaving, but don't think I'm leaving," is what that means. I will be with you always, and we can trust in Him for that. Sometimes you feel like you're all by yourself. Sometimes you feel like stuff's coming at you too fast. Where is the Lord? Where is my help? He is right there. Trust in Him and use that hope and that assurance to worship Him today and lift up His name. I am glad you're here. If you're a guest today, you're particularly welcome. Thank you for choosing to worship with Fort Creek Baptist Church. We have a welcome card I'd ask you to fill out. It should be in the pew rack or at the welcome table outside the front. Please take a minute and fill one of those out. You can look at your bulletin. It is filled up with all kinds of things that are going on. I will not read it to you, but I want to accentuate a couple of things. Number one is the Brotherhood is Tuesday this coming week. And then today is the Family Fall Fun Night. I never can get that title just right, but y'all know what I'm talking about. It's tonight. Be at 5 o'clock. The championship chili is over in my kitchen right now, getting ready for this evening. I hope that some of you are also participating. How's your chili coming along, Brent? You got it. Got it going. Ready to go. So the chili's at 5. We'll have a full meal, of course, with the chili. Come and enjoy that together, and we'll fellowship. Bring your trunk and your treats and set up across the street. And Katie's going to have a plan for how we're going to do that. We're going to have lots of fun together this evening. You can see all kinds of other things. The youth have an event coming up, and also the seniors. Take note of those, read about them, and be ready and respond to those. Let's have a word of prayer together. Can we do that? Father, we lift up your name. We are nothing, nobody, and we are nowhere without the name of Jesus. So I thank you that you have saved us. I thank you that we can trust fully in your presence with us. I thank you that you sustain us day by day. I thank you that you are waiting to welcome us home. How we love you, how we need you. Use us just like you intend. Make us just what we need to be. I pray that way for me personally. I pray individually that way for each person here. And I pray that together you would do a mighty work in this church. We are not ashamed or hesitant to ask that you would grow us as a church. You would give us the greatest ministry possible. You would expand who we are and what we do and extend the tent, build us up stronger, and make us everything you want Fort Creek Baptist Church to be. And we rejoice in that. We have expectation and great desire to see you work over the long term and to see you work right here with us today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen.
Well, all right, if you will, stand back up with us, and we're going to continue the worship service. A couple of weeks ago, Brent and Ben, we were talking, and we were talking about your testimony. I've never shared a testimony. It's been a burden on my heart. When I was younger, I used to think that I didn't have a testimony. You'd hear people that would talk about they were pulled out of the gutter, they were on drugs or drinking or stuff like that, and I always thought, I don't have much of a testimony. The older I get, I realize that I do. I was born with a loving mother and a loving father in a Christian home. I was raised in Fort Creek. I have been so very blessed. Yeah, I think it's an amazing testimony. And I look around the room and I see other people that's got the same testimony as I do. Now, were we perfect? No, because I know a lot of y'all were with me at the time, some of the stuff. So, no. Maybe I shouldn't say that, but anyway. But it's true. That's what makes us who we are. Share your testimony with somebody. No matter where you came from or what your life has been like. Share it with somebody from the lowest lows to the highest of highs. Make sure somebody knows your testimony. This is how great our God is.
Trembles at his voice. How great!
right where you are. Worship Him right now. He's so good to us.
How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to you again and say thank you for allowing us to be here. Thank you for providing us such a wonderful place to come and worship you. Lord, we thank you for your word, your message that you have for us today. Lord, we thank you for your instructions that you've given us that are in your word. Lord, give us the strength to follow and do the things that you have called us to do. Lord, I pray that you remove the obstacles that are in front of us that keep us from serving you like we should. Lord, and be the person and the Christian that you've called us to be. Lord, I pray for our nation, this country, Lord. There are so many things that are going on and so many things that are just not good. Lord, and I pray that you'll put your hand back on this country and that fellow Christians, we will stand up and stand up for what is right and be against what is wrong, Lord. Lord, you've blessed us all through the years. You do so many things for us individually each and every day, Lord, that we just take for granted. Small things, but they're huge things. Lord, we thank you for every blessing that you've bestowed upon us. Lord, we thank you for being a God that hears our prayers and answers our prayers. And Lord, thank you for being the only God. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
So this morning, we've been singing about how great God is to us and how faithful he is to us. But one thing we need to remember to know is, why is he that way? It's because he loves us. Jesus loves us.
In chains, the world had a hold of me.
we are, to care about anything that matters in this world. The Lord has made us. He's designed this place for us, and He's constantly working to get us where we need to be and who we need to be. All of that is because He loves us so much, and we rejoice to be together. We rejoice to be able to worship Him together. I want to invite you to come and pray. I think sometimes we miss what is really the true aim and purpose of prayer. Yes, it is to deal with needs and challenges and problems. Yes, there are all kinds of things we need to bring before the Lord. But first, we bring ourselves before the Lord. Prayer is a love conversation. It is talking to the Lord in a way that is most personal and most intimate in your hearts. I encourage you, spend your time in prayer just expressing to the Lord how much you love Him. Let's do that together this morning. Father, I pray together you would give each of us a vision, an insight, just a glimpse of what our lives would be like if it were not for you. Yes, I know, God, that's a scary thing to ask. But I pray that it would be such an impact, such a forceful reminder in our hearts that we could again love you with everything we've got. We could again lift up your name and make you the center and the purpose of our lives. We understand that you deserve everything. We understand that you are Lord and we call you Lord, but we so often don't live like you're our Lord. And so you deserve everything we've got. You deserve all of our praise and all of our worship. I pray that we could see how desperately we need you each and every minute, each and every day. Father, even recognizing the challenge, the danger, praying this way, I pray, Father, if there's somebody here in this room that's forgotten their first love, that's dismissed or diminished what they feel for you and how they care about you, I pray that you would just shake them up. I pray that you would stir their hearts. I pray that you would challenge them in their lives. I pray, Father, that there would be a disciplining, a correction, a call to repentance. How often and how badly we each need that, God. That you would call us back to yourselves. That you'd show us again why we can't make it without you. That you would remind us of all that you have done for us. How great you love us. How shabby and hollow is our love for you. Change that in our hearts, God. Change it so our desire and our motives and our passion, everything, derives from Christ and points to Christ and leads us closer to you. And I pray that that would be our true witness. I pray that it would be clear in our lives that the change has happened, that Jesus is in our hearts. And this world has nothing on who Christ is. Let us live this way and live with such enthusiasm for you and such bedrock faith in you, such obedience to your word. Put us right where we need to be, God. Show us right what we need to see, Lord. Tell us just what we need to hear. Not only did you come to use us to know you and to change our hearts, but now to use us so that we can be a force for good in this world. The place of change for lost people and broken people and so many folks that are still in the dark. Let them see the light of Christ in our lives. And pray that we would be a church filled with light and we would shine and show forth and declare the praises of our Lord and our Savior. I pray that this would be a new day. We could see that way and think that way. And it'd be what we're about and who we are. And Father, we pray that you'd give us a heart for those who are in conditions and situations of real need and real pain and real suffering. Give us a pastor's heart for each of those people to minister to them, care for them, and to love them, and not make excuses and not cast them to the side and not run out of patience, but show more love every day. You don't do anything less than that for us. I pray now for your word. Make it true and clear in our hearts and give us a longing for it. And I pray this in Jesus' name, for his sake and his glory. Amen. We're wrapping up chapter 3 in the book of James. We're kind of turning the round of the track, and we're on the second half and even later into that, just two more chapters. I hope you're appreciating James. When you hear, yes, my pastor's in James again, nobody roll their eyes. Okay, the answer to that is amen. I love James because God put James here. And sometimes we need a challenge. Sometimes we need a wake-up call. Sometimes God's got to just take us by the collar and rattle us around a little bit. That's why James is in the Bible, along with so many other places and passages. Today is a real challenge in the area of our thinking and our wisdom, how we make decisions, how we make our choices. James is very clear about what's supposed to happen when it comes to exercising wisdom. William French Anderson is known as the father of gene therapy. He was a Time Magazine Hero of Medicine in 1997. He was worth hundreds of millions of dollars after selling his company, his research company at that point. In July of 2006, William French Anderson was convicted of sexually molesting a child. It was the daughter of one of his friends who actually worked for him. And it was over a four-year period. In a press conference after the conviction, his attorney said this. Now listen very carefully. His attorney said, "Nothing about having an IQ of 176 means that you have good judgment." Now my conclusion, my summary of that is very simple. You can be really, really smart and really, really dumb at the very same time. You can make all kinds of great decisions and have great success in one direction in life and be an abject failure, a train wreck, a whole circle of destruction in a different area or in the more important areas of life. We see people all the time that are this wonderful picture of greatness and strength and success and money. They just ooze this idea of success, and on the inside, they are completely wiped out. Completely destroyed. They don't know the front from the back. They don't know up from down. And their lives are headed for destruction. We are in James chapter 3, the end of that chapter. Listen to what James, what the Bible has to say about this situation. Verse 13, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Who's got good sense? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom," quotation marks, "wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, even demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness." The focus of this passage is wisdom. Wisdom. The focus is wisdom. It's a simple comparison between what is called in verse 15, earthly wisdom, and in verse 17, heavenly wisdom. Those two categories, earthly wisdom of the world, heavenly wisdom, or we might call it godly wisdom. The difficulty here for most of us is not in recognizing that wisdom exists. We know there is good decision making and bad decision making. We don't have a problem recognizing different varieties of wisdom, more success, less success. We can realize you can get things right and have progress in the way you think and make certain choices, or you can get things wrong and have a mess in the way you think, making bad choices. The problem, though, comes in being fully aware of the cost of worldly wisdom. This is what James is trying to point out to us. Not just that there are two types and only two types of wisdom, but that one is really, 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 really good, and one is really, 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 really bad. Two types of wisdom, and James is trying to convince us of the value of heavenly wisdom and the cost of worldly wisdom. That's the ultimate aim, the cost and the value. And he goes into great detail. In fact, we're going to go through every term that he uses with as much time as we have to do that and really get at those two categories, the cost and the value. We need to clearly learn what wisdom is. We need to know the two categories that the Bible is trying to teach us, and then drill down on how hard is the cost. If you make these decisions this way, in this direction, it's going to cost you. How big, how painful, how difficult it will be. So I want to be very meticulous and very detailed in getting at what is said in these five or six verses. That's why the page is as long as it is. It might be a challenge for you to go and study some more or read it through some more and dig deeper even on your own. Wisdom is a predominant subject in God's Word. It is over and over and over again. I looked up the various usages of the words that are related to wisdom. Words like the mind, just mind, or my mind, or minds, all kinds of derivatives of the word mind. There are 164 occurrences. The word think, thinking, thought, there are 131 occurrences. The word wisdom, 218 occurrences. Now, at this point in my list, I read every single one of those. I read every single one of those verses, and I thought I was probably getting kind of to the end of that. And then I looked up the word understanding 249 times. I read three or four of those, and I thought, okay, I've probably done this enough. Over and over again. Then I got to the word knowledge 132 times, and then the words insight and discernment reference. Wisdom is referenced in various ways, various terminology, almost 1,000 times in God's Word. 900 and something, almost 1,000 times, God's trying to communicate to His people how to think, how to figure stuff out, how to know and understand and see and perceive and go. Right direction, wrong direction. Right group, wrong group. Right ideas, wrong ideas. So almost 1,000 times. We make lots of decisions, don't we? Every day we're making decisions. We're trying to see and figure out and understand. If we were working on a definition of wisdom, the Oxford Dictionary says wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. Experience, been there before. Knowledge, here's kind of the technicality of how these things work. And then good judgment, here's what I'm going to do. Here's the decision I'm trying to make. Webster's says it's knowledge and the capacity to make due use of it. So you can have great information and still make bad decisions. So it's putting all that together. Ivester's Dictionary says it is the capacity in your mind and soul, not just your mind, but it comes also from your heart, to observe, gather, and evaluate information for right decisions. So you got to see what's going on. You got to know what's really happening. You're not getting faked out by the fake news. You understand the ramifications, the other issues. You hear something, the first thing you think is, I wonder if that's true or not. You don't jump to conclusions. I did this to Randy Martin this morning, and instantly I thought, okay, I've messed up already. You wait and get all the information, you figure stuff out, and you put that information into a process to evaluate it. You sort it. This is important. This is not important. This is a biblical value. This really doesn't matter. This is the way the world thinks. This is the way God thinks. This might be true. This I know is true. You've got to be able to organize. Wisdom is what does that. And then you're able to make the right kind of decision. So it's a simple concept with profound implications. We make decisions all the time. Some require little wisdom, what kind of toothpaste you're going to use. Some require great wisdom, who you're going to marry, where you're going to work. Am I going to be faithful to values that are important or not? So we make all these decisions, but in those decisions, the Bible points out that wisdom only comes from two places. Y'all with me? Don't check out on me already. I know there's going to be a lot of teaching material here this morning. Wisdom only comes from two places. That's the Bible plainly describing for us. You only have two sources from where you're going to get your ideas from. Now already the world, one of those places tells you that's not true. The world tells you there's all kinds of different camps and collections of information, all kinds of different flows and foundations for how you might choose or pick or decide, and it doesn't really matter. The Bible says no. There is only one grouping of information known as worldly wisdom. There is only one grouping of information and choices known as biblical or godly or heavenly wisdom. So we've got to know what those are and how they really function. Now, when we choose in the world, when we evaluate wisdom in the world, we evaluate typically based on the outcome. I do this thing, getting my information, I make this decision, I get downstream from that, and then I say, was that a good decision or a bad decision? Did it pay off for me? Did it work? The Bible says that the right way to evaluate wisdom is not what it produces, but where it comes from. Where it comes from. What is the source of the wisdom? See, you can make decisions that are biblical, solid, sure, secure, but you may not immediately see the fruit of that decision. You're building foundational kinds of things in your lives. If you put the foundation down, where does it go? It's underground, right? You don't get to see the foundation. But I promise you, whatever you're building on top of it will either rise or fall based on the condition of that foundation. So we're not looking initially at the outcome of the decision. We want to know where this comes from. So the Bible declares that wisdom's significance is on where it comes from and not what it leads to. This passage, yes, it does focus on results. Lots of results. But James doesn't go to results until he tells you where the source is for the knowledge and the wisdom. It's a long list, but we've got to know what we're looking at before we even think about where it's going to lead us to. I want to do something, just a little study of biblical references that use other terms. And those terms, I'm expecting, will kind of expand how we understand the two categories. So this idea of worldly wisdom is called lots of other things throughout Scripture. It's described in some different ways using different terms. And I'm respectful of the time, so I'm just going to kind of throw these at you. And probably can't comment on all of them, but you can gather an understanding and a sense of them. Earthly wisdom. Worldly wisdom in Scripture, variously called these things. In Proverbs 12:8, it talks about a warped mind. A warped mind. You're not balanced. You're not secure in the way you think. Isaiah 44:18 talks about a closed mind. You're not open to direction or understanding. You are set on a thing and locked into that thing. Mark 3:21. You might remember this episode. Jesus has just begun his ministry. He is teaching some radical ideas that's causing people to have to decide if they like it and they're interested in it. And we're told in Mark 3:21 that his family came to put him away because they thought Jesus had lost his mind. They thought he had gone off the deep end. See, worldly wisdom thinks they know what they're talking about. Arrogance and worldly wisdom partner up pretty close together. Those are going to be the first two categories in James's description of the outcome of worldly wisdom. So they thought, we got to put the God of the universe in a home because he has lost his mind. Isn't that interesting? In Romans 1:28, it is called a depraved mind, like an evil mind. In Romans 8:5, it says those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. So if you're lost, that's all you've got is a sin nature, and your mind is focused there. If you're a Christian, you still have a sin nature, and you're in danger all the time of putting your mind on the sin nature. In Romans 8:6, the next verse, it says, it is the mind of sinful man. This is the way sinful people think. 1 Corinthians 1:26 talks about wisdom by human standards, worldly wisdom. 1 Corinthians 3:18 says wisdom by the standards of this age. Have you ever noticed things that everybody thought was smart 20 years ago? They don't think those things are smart anymore. Who ever thought that a man could have a baby? But now, voila, that's what they think. And they think they are right and good and true. Wise by the standards of the age. 1 Corinthians 14:20 says they are thinking like children. You have the mind of a child. You don't know what you're even working on. 2 Corinthians 3:14, I like this one. They are dull minds. They're just kind of clouded. They don't have light and insight. 2 Corinthians 4:4 goes a step further and calls them blinded minds. They cannot even see. Colossians 2:18 says it is an unspiritual mind of the flesh. 1 Timothy 6:5, again, a corrupt mind. 2 Timothy 3:8, a depraved mind. So over and over, I would guess every page of Scripture, you find some kind of reference to thinking, to how you process and understand and choose what my life's about, where I'm going to go, how I'm going to live. Every single page, it is that important. We can easily recognize the results of worldly wisdom. It is the fruit of poor decisions. You live your whole life in search of worldly happiness. Whatever the world says makes you happy, you chase that for a while, then you chase the next thing, then you chase the next thing, only to realize at the end that there is no such thing as worldly happiness. There is absolutely nothing in the world that can produce long-term functioning happiness. You divorce the only good man you've ever known because you need to find yourself. And then the problem is that you take the same messed up self to the next relationship. If you don't know what you're really thinking and how this really works, then you're in real trouble. You like to get drunk, get high, get wasted, get chill, whatever the latest cockamamie phrase is, not realizing that at the same time, the problems that you started with will be waiting for you when you are undrunk or unwasted or unchill or whatever you become. And lots of times, those problems will now be worse. How many men have ruined their lives and their families and their marriages? Because they got to get some kind of substance in their body so they can't feel whatever it is that's bothering them. This is worldly wisdom. And the world thinks this way. It was just a fling, a momentary lapse. I deserve a little fun. And your true relationships are ruined forever. I don't just mean your marriage. Business relationships, your integrity and character are destroyed. I've got to make more money. Jesus said, do not be deceived. a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. How many people are living their life for stuff? For money, possessions, pleasures, toys. And that is not what life is about. You spend all your time at work. It's for the family, of course. But the family won't even know who you are. And you've ruined your family. They need you far more than they need your money. Please understand. Worldly wisdom says, eat, drink, and be merry. Worldly wisdom says, I did it my way. Nobody can tell me what to do. Money makes the world go round. Worldly wisdom says, let's print another $1 trillion. Everything will be fine. No problems at all. $30 trillion plus we are in debt now. It will never, ever, ever be paid off. Nobody talks about this. Nobody thinks about the ramifications. What's going to happen to our whole system of life? Because worldly wisdom just keeps on keeping on. We're on a road to destruction. It feels good, do it. That's what the world says. Or my favorite, this is great wisdom, everybody's doing it. I can't wait to get in on whatever that is, right? How brilliant, everybody's doing it. Worldly wisdom says all religions are the same. The Bible is a myth. Jesus was just a good man. The cross is meaningless. Creation is all by chance, evolution. Humanity is inherently good. That's why everybody's always so nice to one another. And there's no crime anywhere. That's why there hasn't been a war or a break-in or a murder in hundreds of years. Because humanity is inherently good. Worldly wisdom says, how could a man die 2,000 years ago and have anything at all to do with my life today? They think they've got it all figured out. This is the way the world thinks. Ultimately, they will come up with any idea they can and make every effort they can to avoid submitting themselves to God, who created them, who loves them, who died for their sins, who has a marvelous, overwhelming, amazing plan for their lives. And they reject all of that in their wisdom and their smarts. Let's talk about heavenly wisdom for just a little bit. Also called godly wisdom. I like that phrase, godly wisdom. I could have made just as long a list as the biblical passages on earthly wisdom, but I think just a few of these will be sufficient. Primarily, you just need to know that if you're going to think the way God thinks, it's going to be opposite of the world, okay? Whatever the world says is right is wrong. In Isaiah, they talk about exchanging the truth of God for a lie. They talk about what used to be up is now down, and what used to be down is now up. It's been completely inverted. This is what the world does to the wisdom of God. So in Mark 5, verse 15, the Gerasene demoniac is healed and he's straightened out. You remember he used to be chained. He would break the chains. He lived in the graveyard. He would howl at the moon. He would cut himself. He's dressed in rags. But Jesus healed him. He removed the demon and set this man right. And then the people of the town were there. They saw this man. The Bible says they saw him dressed and sitting in his right mind. In the world, it's crazy land. Can I say it that way? It's crazy land. They don't know what they're doing, and they dress themselves up in the most grotesque caricature of wisdom and truth. And if you get straightened out, the Bible says you come into your right mind. You get the right mind. Well, another one of my great favorites is the prodigal son. I think I've been in conversations with many of you talking about the hope that this passage conveys for people that we care about that are out there. I mean out there physically and out there in a metaphorical sense. They're gone in the way they think. This son went to his father and said, hey, dad, give it now. Give me now. Shockingly, the father gave him his inheritance, knowing what was going to happen. Well, the kid went off. He wasted it on riotous living. There are different ways that's translated, but you get the idea. He went to Vegas. He laid it all on the tables and bought all the women and the booze and the food he could. He enjoyed it until, guess what? It's gone. It's gone. And in the Bible, he got himself a little job feeding the hogs, which is the lowest, most horrible thing that a Jew could ever do in their minds. And the Bible says he's there in the trough. He's not making enough money, so he eats the hog slop with the hogs. And then something happened. Do you remember how Jesus described it? Jesus said he came to his senses. Something turned. A thought came into his mind. Now, you know that thought comes from the Holy Spirit. God reached out and touched that young man's heart and said, hey, wake up. Hey, come alive. Hey, look at the truth. See it the right way. He came to his senses. I have people in my life, and every single one of us probably do too, where we are praying for them and waiting for them to come to their senses, for their minds to function right. We could go back to Romans 8, 6, which gives us the both sides of this. The mind of sinful man is death. I said that one already. And then the verse goes on to say, the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. There you are. You have the sinful mind, which is death, the spiritual mind, the mind of the Spirit of God, which is life and peace. Colossians 3:2 says, set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Learn to think the way that you would be expected to think as a child of God, a follower of Christ. And then 1 Corinthians 2:16, a statement that would take quite a while for us to unpack. And in fact, I think this is kind of the guiding principle of the Christian life. We don't talk about this statement very much at all, but boy, we sure need to. It kind of is the archetype, the overwhelming declaration of all these other ideas. It's the umbrella under which everything else about biblical wisdom really falls. Here's the verse. For who has known the mind of the Lord? So that's thinking like the Lord, or understanding what he understands, that he might instruct him. The idea from that, that quote in Isaiah 40. We don't equal up to God. We can't think like God. He's God. We're not God. And yet, Paul says this, but we have the mind of Christ. That's something we need to contemplate a little bit. If you ever do any meditation, there's a point for you to meditate on. What in the world would it mean to have the mind of Christ? The Holy Spirit lives in our hearts. We know that we have fully the presence of Christ living within us, stirring our souls, speaking to us, giving us right and wrong. Go for it. Don't go there. Encouragements, helps, drive and direction. But we so often think of that in such a spiritualized sense that we don't realize he's talking about thought process, mind, knowledge of ideas and choices and opportunities and possibilities. We have the mind of Christ. Not can have, not will have, not should have. You, as a Christian, you have the Spirit of God. And you have the mind of Christ. Don't ever say, I can't think like Jesus. You have the ability to think the way Jesus thinks. Don't ever say, I can't be that good. Yes, you can. That's your flesh making excuses. Don't ever say, I can't understand the Bible. Every single one of us has probably said that at some point. You have the mind of Christ. Not just like a great interpreter of Scripture. The mind of Christ is the Scripture. He's the living Word of God. He's the embodiment of God's Word. So within us, He's there to open the path, to point the way, to show us, to help us to think right. And my, how badly we need to learn to think right. I think this is so important. You know whole denominations that are either far into emotionalism and it's all about the Spirit, the Spirit, the Spirit, and whole denominations that are far into some type of deep theology and it's all about the Father, the Father, the Father. And some denominations where it's all about evangelism and they talk about Jesus, 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 the gospel, the gospel, the gospel. We got to bring this into balance. We're supposed to be all three of those together with the presence of Christ in each of our hearts and each of our minds. Maybe we need to start saying, Jesus lives in my heart and my mind. We know about the heart. We talk about Jesus in our heart. I have the Holy Spirit. Where does He live? Here or here? And the answer is yes. Yes, He lives there, all over you. And He wants to come out in so many different ways. So time's pretty much up, and I only have 17 points remaining. 19, praise God. We're going to work on these. Again, some of these are obvious. I don't have a lot of material, but I do want to go through each of them. And I think it's very important for us to understand where this goes, what this wisdom will do. So the cost of worldly wisdom, I'm going to do two categories, and we're jumping around in the text. In verse 14, cost of worldly wisdom is bitter envy. This is where your decisions are based on what? Me and somebody else. Somebody has it, I want it. I compare, I desire, I rationalize, I seize. It's mine, it's mine. I want it. They don't deserve it. There is a reason I believe James mentions this one first, because this is where a lot of worldly wisdom goes to. Bitter, envy, and then the second one I believe is just as important, very similar, selfish ambition. Back to the story about the geneticist, William French Anderson, the judge at his trial, you heard the quote from the lawyer, the judge had this to say. He said that William French Anderson, they called him French, said he had caused the girl incalculable emotional damage. We get that. But then he said this, because of intellectual arrogance, he thought he could get away with whatever he wanted. Arrogance. I'm somebody. I deserve this. Everybody else is doing it. It sure looks like fun. It's just a little thing. I'm a Christian. I can confess afterwards. Boy, that's some serious arrogance. And the way the world thinks, we can justify it, excuse it, make all the excuses in the world, and we don't recognize what this really is coming from. Then it's called earthly in verse 15. I want you to see 3, 4, and 5 particularly. Earthly is of the world. And remember the list of sin's influences. James talks about all sin is of the world, of the flesh, of the devil. And then right here in this passage, he's going back to that same emphasis. So he calls it earthly. This is sin's framework. All sin is of the world. And then he calls it unspiritual. This is sin's nature of the flesh. It is not of the spirit. It's of the flesh, which is inside of us. We're always fighting that. And then he calls it of the devil, which is sin's master. So you have the framework, the nature, and the master. This is worldly wisdom. It's always about those things. Number 6 is disorder. Got to get this one down. When the world makes decisions, it's always going to end up in a mess. It may look good for a while. Those giant million-dollar-plus mansions look really nice. And the pictures they post on Instagram look really nice. Those are filtered pictures, okay? There's a lot more going on there than what you see in the picture. Those are deceptions. It's a trick to make you want it. Your flesh tunes into that. I got to have this. I need some of this attention. I need some of these worldly benefits, the world's rewards. What does the Bible say in Matthew 6? Where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. The stuff's not going to last. Even if you are famous and people love you and pat you on the back, that's not going to last. If you make it till the end, you're still going to die. And you're going to die sad and lonely. Think about all the actors and actresses and politicians and famous people that you used to hear about 20, 30 years ago. Where are they now? Who are they now? What do they have now? This is disorder. And then every evil practice, which kind of brings it all home. You're not just failing to do what's best. The wisdom of this world leads to evil. It is evil in its category. It is evil in its classification. It is evil in its identity and direction. If you think like the world and you act like the world, you only become evil like the world. I don't want any of this in my life. How about you? I don't want any of these things. I know I don't want this kind of heart. I don't want this kind of payoff. This is why James is telling us what it really does. Then there is the value of heavenly wisdom. And this is a longer list on purpose, I believe. Verse 13 calls it the good life. That's pretty basic, right? Worldly wisdom, it would be the bad life. Heavenly wisdom would be the good life. You only get the good life by doing things God's way. You only get the good life by doing things God's way. The next one is humility. One great poet said, wisdom is oftentimes nearer when we stoop than when we soar. He's captured the contrast. This is why James, in the list of worldly wisdom, the first one and the second one, remember, bitter envy, selfish ambition. Now James starts the list of heavenly wisdom, humility. Humility. If you want to be wise in the eyes of God, then you are focused not just on yourself. You submit to God's word, to God's rule, to God's truth. That's humility. Then pure, number three, pure means free of contamination. You can't mix the two. You can't use worldly ideas and come out with God's end, God's results. You can't use God's ideas and get what the world says is great and wonderful. Evil always corrupts whatever it touches. It pollutes whatever it touches. So your heart's got to be pure for you to be able to make godly decisions. How do I get that? Well, Jesus has got to live in there to start with. So if you don't know Jesus, if you've never been to the place where you've called out to him, I'm a sinner, I know my sin has condemned me, and I deserve every bit of that. I need help. I need salvation. I need to be healed on the inside. You call out to Jesus, you confess that sin to him. You're right, Lord, I am a sinner. You ask him to come and live, take up residence in your heart to change your life. Every time that happens, he's faithful to do it. Every time somebody asks him, he steps right into that place and you are a new and wonderful recreation. But that brings you to purity, and then you learn to exercise godly wisdom. Number four is peace loving. So wisdom, according to God, is not about me getting what I want, right? What does peace loving imply? There are relational connections in the decisions that you make. What does the world do to other people in their decisions? It's me, get out of my way. If you don't get out of my way, I'm going to run you down. If you do something I don't like, it's me, so I'm coming to tell you I don't like it. You need to stop doing that thing. Get your tree limbs off of my side of the fence. What's wrong with you? What a horrible thing this is. Your dog barks too much. I wish you'd never moved in here. Boy, now you're really showing them what Jesus looks like. Right? The wisdom of God is peace, loving, and considerate. So notice, not just how I can get along with my neighbors or my wife, but how I can honor my neighbors and my wife. Not just what helps me, But what's going to help somebody else? What's going to bless somebody else? What's going to visibly demonstrate Christ to somebody else? That's what it means to be considerate. Number six, submissive. You hear that word humility again. But Abraham Lincoln actually expresses the meaning of this very well. He said, "During the Civil War, I have been driven many times to my knees by the overwhelming conviction that I had nowhere else to go. My wisdom and that of all about me seemed insufficient for the day. The country's falling apart in his hands. I don't know what to do." Wouldn't it be great to have a president who could say that? Wouldn't it be great to have a leader with a little bit of humility that could submit their hearts to God's word? I would love to have a leader who would stand up and say, "Guys, we're in a mess." Well, they won't even say that, right? "We're in a mess. I need some help. I don't really know what to do. The next 24 hours, I'm going to my prayer closet with my Bible." Hey, men, I'd vote for that guy every time. Every time. It is submissive. It is full of mercy. Number seven, back to the idea of your relationships. Now you're forgiving those people who have injured you in their foolish worldly decisions. You're giving them another chance. You know that you're going to be offended in this world, right? And the world says, "Get out of my face." The Christian says, "I forgive you. I forgive you. Let's try again. Let's try again." Full of mercy, full of good fruit. So there's a payoff. Who benefits from this decision? Who does it help? Who does it bless? How does it bear fruit for the kingdom? Number nine is impartial. So not favoritism. I'm not favoring this neighbor and hating that neighbor over there. Sincere is number 10, because you're talking about the motive. Why do we act this way? The Bible says to do it, and God's always telling me what I've done wrong, and I want to be a good Christian, and I need to do good things so I can go to heaven when I die. The Bible doesn't say that, by the way. That's the flesh. Why do we do good things? Because we want to. We love the Lord. We want Him to be satisfied in our lives and be able to bless us. So we are sincere. Peacemaking is number 11. Already seen peace loving. Now you're active in bringing peace to other relationships. Not just your own relationships. You're helping other people. When they're trying to decide, you become a counselor for other people who are lost and confused and in the dark. And you're able to say, "You know, I see how you're thinking about this. I see how it would be easy to go in that direction. Can I show you what the Bible says about that?" Isn't that an easy way to talk to people? Not, "Here's what the Bible says, you big dummy." Which is the way some Baptists talk to people. Shame on us. "Can I show you what God's word says about that?" Or, "You know, I was in that situation one time myself, testimony. And I remember how badly I messed that up. And then I discovered, here's what the Bible says. And once I made that change," peacemaking. And then number 12, raise a harvest of righteousness. Raise a harvest of righteousness. You can see kind of the progression. Each one of those benefits gets a little more bold, a little deeper in our hearts, a little more advancing in the ultimate aim of the fullness of Christ in our hearts and in our lives. You see, the Bible says that once you become a Christian, you become righteous immediately. Now, not your own righteousness. You're not perfect or great or excellent or better than anybody. It's the righteousness of Christ. Thank God for the righteousness of Christ. And yet, once you become that category, now you exercise the wisdom of the Spirit so that you produce an outpouring of righteousness. That's pretty good stuff, isn't it? This is where our lives are supposed to be, who we're supposed to be, how we're supposed to function. And it ought to be a day-to-day thing. If God's got any wisdom on what kind of toothpaste I ought to choose, I want to know. Okay? Is toothpaste a silly thing? Well, you could say that until you don't have any teeth anymore. Right? So every decision we need to be making sure and clear and with the right kind of wisdom. Make good choices, brothers and sisters. But know where it comes from. What does God say about this? How is the Lord working here? What is He trying to do in this situation in my life? What is the verse that relates to this? Google makes it easy. I'm not a fan of all the gadgets and the gizmos that leads the world in all kinds of bad directions. But I have discovered if you remember a biblical phrase or an idea in the Bible, you can just ask Google where that is. And every single time I've done that, it'll take me to some biblical website and some wise person who will tell me the verse. And a lot of times they're writing about that verse. Now, use discernment, obviously, but you can find biblical wisdom a lot easier these days than you could even 20 years ago. It's right there. It's at your fingertips. Use God's wisdom. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this time. Thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for the reality that the Bible is. So many people think it's extraterrestrial, it's of a different place, and it's out of touch, and it's confusing. We know your word is clear and direct. It is the very source of life for us, living and active and sharper than a double-edged sword. Your word and your spirit we rely on to know what to do every single day. Help us to make godly decisions. Help us to know why, what they are, and to work at it. I pray, Lord, just as James started this letter, that you would give us wisdom. If any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously and without fault. Give us wisdom. Now we understand how desperately we need it. I pray that we would live this week and beyond with a testimony and a boldness for Christ. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I want you to just pray this morning. Tell the Lord we need wisdom. We need to know how to think. Maybe there's a specific thing that God's pointing out to you. Man, I've goofed that up pretty bad. I need to figure out how to straighten that up. Show me the direction. Give me what to do and what to say. Pray that way. If you're here and you need Jesus, let's talk about that. You come, tell me. If you want to know. If you're here and you want to be a member of this church, I'm just going to tell you, it's my conviction, there is no better place than this place. Come and be part of this family and let's serve the Lord together. That new journey, that new relationship. You respond as the Lord leads this morning.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my Master say, I gave my life to ransom thee. Surrender your all today. Wherever He leads, I'll go.
I'm glad you're here today. I hope you'll come back tonight, that you don't have to be a kid and you don't have to have a trunk. Just come and be part of the fellowship. I got a piece of candy I'll give you out of my trunk if you need some candy. Come and celebrate that with us. We're going to have a great time, 5 to 7. Katie, would you close us in prayer this morning?